Today I'm going to give you 5 tips that'll help you get a super strong starter and use it to its full potential. Even if you aren't a beginner, you might learn something new. Hi, I'm Sune, and I'm a food geek. Today I'm going to give you 5 tips that'll help you manage your starter and get it better than it's ever been before. If you don't have a sourdough starter, I have a very simple method that you can follow. It's linked in the card above. For this video, I'll assume that your starter is 100% hydration, which means that it has the same amount of water and flour by weight. I will also assume that it's established and that you can bake with it. If you're new to this channel, I bake a lot of sourdough bread and I make delicious food from all over the world. If you want to see more of this content, please join me by subscribing and ringing the bell so you won't miss any future videos. Let's get started with the tips. Stay until the end for a bonus tip. Tip number 1. When is my starter ready to bake with? Well, the short answer is that it's always ready. I did an experiment where I compared baking with a well-fed starter with one that had been sitting in the fridge for a week, and honestly, there wasn't that big of a difference in the final bread. Watch the video here. The long answer is that if you want the best oven spring, you should use your starter from when it peaks until about 12 hours after that. So how do you know when the starter has peaked? Well, have a look at it once in a while, and when it starts to deflate, you know it's peaked. Tip number 2, maintain only a small amount of starter. I've seen people who have gallons of discard in the fridge because they maintain a lot of starter. Truth be told, I only keep around 100 grams or so in the fridge. I will usually keep an active starter outside of the fridge, which is the one that I use for building a starter for my baking. So say I need 125 grams of starter for my bread, I'll add maybe 25 grams on top of that, that's 150 grams. I'll divide that by 2, and that's 75 grams of flour and 75 grams of water. So I'll add some starter that I have left over from my last bake. So that's 25 grams, and that's a third of 75 grams. So the feeding is about 1:3:3. That way, I'll never have any discard, so no wasted flour. If I do want to make a discard recipe, I'll just make some starter the same way I do for my bread. Tip number 3, temperature matters. When growing your starter, the temperature that the starter is kept at is very important. Your starter will grow all the way down to 4 degrees Celsius, 39 degrees Fahrenheit, but below that it'll stop growing. Theoretically, yeast can survive up to 60 degrees Celsius, 140 degrees Fahrenheit, but I'm pretty sure that the temperature where it starts to suffer is much lower than that. I know that it's fine up to at least 40 degrees Celsius, 104 degrees Fahrenheit. The higher the temperature, the faster the starter will grow and mature. That also means that when the starter has peaked, the faster it'll deflate and become sour. This can be used to your advantage, but you just need to be aware of it. If you always grow your starter at the same temperature, the growth rate will be comparable, making it easy to estimate when your starter will peak. That ties into tip number 4. Use proportional feeding to your advantage. So I'm sure that you've heard that you can feed your starter in different proportions. Commonly, people feed at 1:1:1, which means one part starter, one part flour, and one part water. This is by weight, by the way. Another common one is 1:2:2, which means one part starter, two parts flour, and two parts water. So what does that mean for your starter, and can you just switch between these proportions at will? Well, it doesn't mean your starter will be different no matter what proportion you feed at. It'll always be 100% hydration starter if the last two numbers are the same. So you can use whatever proportion you want, but why would you want to use a different one? Well, if you feed at 1:1:1, your starter might peak at 3 hours at room temperature. This is just an example. But if you feed at 1:2:2, your starter will take twice as long to peak at the same temperature. So that would be 6 hours. So say you want to use your starter at 8 in the morning, you might feed your starter at 8 in the evening and feed it at 1 to 4 to 4. That'll take 12 hours to peak. Just be aware that since temperature also changes the speed, this is best done in a proofer to keep the temperature constant. I will usually grow my starter in my proofer set to 30 degrees Celsius, 86 degrees Fahrenheit. That way I know the precise timings of my starter. I put a link in the description for the proofer that I use if you're interested. Tip number 5, flour choice. Once your starter is established, you can pretty much feed it any flour you want, even gluten-free or bleached flour. Using whole grain flours will intensify the sourness of your starter, especially if you use rye flour. You don't need to maintain starters with different flours, you can just switch. If you feed your starter at 1 to 5 to 5 in a few feedings, almost none of the original flour is left in the starter. So those were the 5 tips. Now it's time for a bonus tip, which incidentally is the most important one. How do you make your starter super strong? It's actually very easy. Feed your starter at a super high proportion 3 to 4 times. If my starter needs a kick, I'll feed it at 1 to 50 to 50. And it takes a long time to peak, but it's worth it. Remember, tip number 3, keep it at a high temperature to make it grow faster. I hope you learned something today. See you next time.